said it was last night, probably Monday or two.
Okay, it's come to order. Can we have a roll call, please?
All right. Eric?
Present.
Ms. Enke?
Here.
Ms. Hubbard?
Present.
Mr. Jacobs? Dr. Sophia? Mr. Marshall? Ms. Mendelson? Mr. Newman?
Here.
Dr. O'Donnell?
Here.
Ms. Shereen?
Here.
Dr. Smith?
Here.
Okay, we have a call.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Would everybody please turn off their cell phones? Including myself. Do we have a motion on adoption of the minutes of May 19, 2016? Yes.
They're supposed to be down there for the chair.
On what? Why don't you tell me?
Yeah, she told you.
Okay.
I've already made a change.
All right, so was there a motion to...
I will do it in 7 minutes.
Is there a second? Second?
Sure.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those not in favor?
So, okay, unanimous?
Yes, it was.
We'll have the first call of the audience. There will be two. None? Quiet group, okay. We're moving right on. All right. Next is the welfare and dangerous dog cases from May and recent animal care center snapshot. Are there any commentary on those? Ms. Shereen.
Dog was kept permanently on a very short chain with no water or shelter, shade in the season. And the permanence was proved by the very large amount of animal waste surrounding the dog and the water bowl upside down with no evidence of water on the ground. And along with that, the laws on cruelty apply here. Part of the law on cruelty says it's cruel and the owner should be charged with if he has committed unnecessary cruelty and or unnecessary suffering of any kind, which this most certainly was. And then in the third paragraph, this case is so very important. Also, being on a chain is in itself extremely cruel, even if there is nothing else wrong. And then I quote the laws here, which the Animal Control Center is not, are not using these laws, but these laws are Tucson City Code Section 4-11B, which is the law on bonding. It says, an animal is deemed to be in distress if it is on a tie. The Pima County Code Section 6.04.1308(4) says, an animal is deemed to be in distress and subject to removal and impoundment if it is on a kennel. So I really wish that the Animal Control Center would start to enforce these laws. Is anybody else want to say anything?
Well, I drove this case, and they came twice. And the first time was a juvenile. But the second time, and the kids said he was a parent. The second time they came out, which was like 3 weeks later, 2 weeks later, the mother was there and said, well, she couldn't walk the dog. And if she can't walk the dog and take care of the dog, she can't leave his hideout. She shouldn't have the dog. I agree, the dog shouldn't have been impounded after the second visit.
Is there, yes?
I also have a problem with this case, because the adult did say, when she was asked if she received notice, she acknowledged that she was aware of the notice. And there was 3 weeks here between the visits. They could have done something else. They should not have allowed that dog to stay at that facility.
I agree. Is there any commentary from that?
Actually, can I move up the table?
Please.
Take anyone's seat. I appreciate everybody's comments regarding this. I'm going to be taking a lot of notes tonight. This will be my first meeting. I mean, to be here to be on the receptive side last time I was here just to observe. With this case in particular, I mean, your points are all valid. There was prior contact where the education component had occurred, and then upon the second contact, I mean, the educational component hadn't happened. So I agree that, you know, there could have been a different stance that was taken. You mean, this is something that we can hopefully work on going forward through some of your direction. I know that's what the point of these meetings are.
I would like them to go back out, and if the dog's on a tie-off, I would like that dog removed.
Okay.
Thank you.
Easily make a follow-up call for that.
Okay. In my notes, I actually give you citations to the relevant laws.
Yes, I review them.
Right there, see them?
You were very thorough.
Ms. Ray, do you have any other comments on any other cases?
Yes, on other cases, yeah. One of these dogs was kept in a crate, located in a crate that didn't have a bottom. Keeping dogs in crates is extremely cruel, and I've been trying to make that point for many years. The mere fact that the dog was in a crate in itself is extremely cruel, and the owner should have been, I think, bonded just for that. Anybody who keeps a dog permanently or for a long time in a crate, and this was a long time, no watering up by it.
They were outside? You were outside?
Well,
it says outside.
Yes, they were outside.
Yeah, outside. But a crate anywhere is cool.
No, I'm making just a point that they were outside, that's all. I'm not saying that was cool.
But,
no, I'm not going to interrupt you. I have a question.
Okay, then just being in a crate by itself, wherever the crate is, and even if the temperature is perfect, even if it has perfect water and food, everything's perfect except that it's in a crate, that is cruel. It comes under the cruelty statute. And owners should be cited for cruelty, and I think the dog should have been bonded, which means taking the dog away from the owner.
My question was, it said the owner came back to redeem the dog. The dogs were impounded. And it says the owner came back to redeem the dog, and Officer Martinez met with the dog owner at the center. But it doesn't say whether the owner got the dogs back. It doesn't say whether they met with the owner and educated.
investigated, the owner and the dog went back and they responded. That just doesn't say what happened at the end of that.
Certainly.
The owner signed and received copies of citations, but it doesn't say if they did the dogs with them.
Okay.
It says at the bottom they were encountered and were not to be returned until the place was cleaned up, so.
And reevaluated.
We don't have a plan.
And reevaluated.
And reevaluated.
Certainly.
We haven't done that yet, probably.
As far as, I mean, the information here is kind of the basis that all that I really have to worry about at this point as well. So again, it's something else that, I mean, I can look into. Normally in these situations, I don't remember seeing anything that had like a permanent hold. Normally what wouldn't be happening in these scenarios is that there would be a hold on the animals until we can have contact with that owner, so the citations can be issued. Then at that time, you mean variables will come into play as to whether the animals are returned or not.
Any more comments on three? Okay, two.
Walter, case two. This owner obviously did value the animal. They were, you know, in vet care, and she said that she felt like, you know, her pedicures, her curves, and her manicures and all that were more important than the animal. And she says here that she will no longer own an animal. Mm-hmm. However, all too often we see people who say, oh, I'm not going to do this again, and then a couple months later, they have another animal. And based upon the talk that we had last month from the attorney, they may or may not take our suggestion, but I would like, when this goes to court, that this person, it be suggested that this person be having, or have a mandate that they cannot own animals. Because this is horrific. No animal should go through this. This is, she treated it like a throwaway piece of garbage.
Certainly, and as you can see, this is actually one case that I actually was actually the only case so far that I've been involved in since being here. So, I mean, I can understand where your point's coming from, and again, we have to be able to rely on the judicial system to make those determinations, because that's, we don't have that control, but we can always.
And I hope CPS checks on her, too, after she has her child.
It's a valid question. I mean, that unfortunately won't be one that will be too heavily involved with, hopefully.
Right.
Okay. Any other comments on this issue?
Again, my notes for number one are wrong here. The laws say an animal on the fire is in distress. As I quote the actual law in the first case. And the bond laws should be used. Because this animal was on a tie-up with wrapped around so that it was only had 2 feet that was not tangled up. Only 2 feet for a, what kind of dog was this?
German Shepherd.
German Shepherd. On a 2-foot chain and with no access to shelter. And it says, if the owner redeems, this owner should not have been allowed to redeem. And again, the law says an animal on a tie-out is in distress as a matter of law. Both city and county.
What's your opinion on this?
Well, again, you mean, there's a lot of things that, you mean, I've been speaking with, I mean, as far as the administration with PAC, about different things that we can do going forward. There are definitely some training things that we have to look into that might be able to help address some of these issues that, I mean, seem to be reoccurring. And what we can do is, again, I've already started talking with some of our prosecutors as well to figure out some of the things that we can do better to maybe help these cases go forward so they'll have higher prosecution rates. So there are conversations and things that have started. You mean, unfortunately, we won't feel this with that light switch. It makes some of these things happen. I know for some of you, this is your the last meeting. So, you mean, I want to just make sure you guys are aware that we're having these conversations. We're talking to the people that we need to in order to move some of these things forward. Okay? That's all I can offer to you tonight.
I have a question. Maybe it's a concern. If somebody has their dog tied up and they put it on a chain, chain of rope, whatever, and that's illegal. We all know that by statute. They go in the house, the dog wraps himself around the tree or the post, whatever it is, and it has a short leash. It's still tied up, whether that chain is 2 feet or 12 feet. So at what point would you figure that education is what these people need and empowerment? How do you discern between educating this person and taking that dog away?
It's really going to be really hard to be able to say that because it's going to be very variable driven. So when you go to these locations, what is the receptive nature of the person that you're talking to? I mean, is it something that you think you can get through education? Because ultimately, when we create laws, we're looking for compliance for people to live inside this box. So there is definitely a component that's there through education to be able to say, okay, can we handle this? I mean, one of the things I every time I talk to the officer so far, for me, I'm looking for them to gain compliance. If they can accomplish that through an educational component, that's great. If they don't feel that is the course of action, if it's going to require citations, that's great as well. If they feel that needs to be impounded and bonded, I want to be able to leave certain levels of discretion to the officers who are on scene, looking at it, talking with the people, because you can get a good feeling sometimes when you're talking to someone that they're at least being receptive. There is a certain level of follow-up and making sure that some of these components are being dealt with. I mean, but there's other things currently factored in that are currently preventing, a good amount of follow-up on some of these cases.
There's a difference between being unkind and being cruel.
Sure.
And I'm glad that, I appreciate your response, because not every dog needs to be taken away from itself as that one can be educated, and that's what our jobs are,
sure,
just to educate the community.
In one of the things,
my question,
sure,
is when you say educated, and earlier you mentioned that they filled the bill for education because they were told this one time that you're not supposed to have a dog on a chain.
Certainly.
So at that point, we understand that that is taken care of, right? They're educated, you told them.
Right.
And those were your words.
Yes.
So do we need to do it twice? I mean, in what cases do we have to go twice and three times? Wouldn't one time be education, second time? I think that was where your question was.
Yeah, I think the second
time is
not the first.
Certainly. And this is kind of where the information kind of coming together. When you went out the first time, especially that the first one that was brought up, they dealt with a juvenile.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes that has to be kind of dealt with a grain of salt because they're probably not the owner, they're probably not the person that's in charge of being that caretaker. And with that first case, when the owner admitted to stating, yes, I was aware and I am willingly expressing that I have not taken care of the situation, again, that shows their inability to take that education component and make the right decision for the animal.
Mm-hmm. So, back to the how many times we would tell them.
Sure.
So, not assuming that first person, assuming it would be me, and you come to me and you tell me, Jeff, you can't tie this dog off. Okay. Whether I get it or I don't know whether maybe it's just going right through my head.
Sure.
Maybe it's not. But that's not the dog's fault. But the point is, we're all responsible. The laws weren't passed, and I get stopped by a cop and he says, you're speeding.
Sure.
And there's an education component, but I'm getting a ticket, right?
Well, sometimes.
It's up to me.
They have to tell you
twice, has to tell me again.
Probably get a ticket.
Probably. So I guess I'm wondering at what point and what discretion are the officers getting on that second time, particularly when it's affecting the animal.
You mean at this point in time, you mean it's...
When have they completed the educational part of it?
I would say after the first attempt.
Okay.
For me personally, for my understanding, my expectations for what I've done within the field. But again, like I was trying to state earlier, that there's some things that we're trying to decipher through various information to be able to figure out what type of training components that we can utilize going forward to help, solidify some of the way we're going to go about dealing with some of these calls.
Are you planning on trying to liaise with places that sell pet supplies to ask them to post something stating that tie-ups are illegal?
That's something we can look into, for sure.
This might be an education component because it is legal to sell them, but it's illegal to use them.
No, absolutely. And a little bit that I've been here in the Tucson area. You do see them at all of the pet stores. So again, the pet stores are a business, they're trying to make their money, and they're not, global to this area, especially over the big national market. And that is something that we can talk with them. However, again, they're private companies, they choose not to participate. It might be a hard thing to do, but hopefully, maybe through PAC, we have some working relationships with PetSmart and whatnot. Maybe we can get something out there. And also, maybe even more so than that, the relationship probably with the veterinary hospitals might be a better educational component. Because at least then you're dealing with owners that are doing the right thing. They're taking their animals commonly to the vets. They're getting the shots, doing those things. So that might be another avenue for education.
Those people probably love type of dogs. The people who are taking the dogs.
Certainly.
Probably won't. Well, my concern is, and I know we have a limited amount of space, the next week is going to be horrible hot. And I'm really concerned about education, when it's going to be 110 degrees out.
Certainly.
And you can't leave your dog tied out. How much time are we going to give them? Because these dogs can't be left out in this weather over the next couple of weeks.
Certainly. The last heat wave that we had, we actually changed our call priorities. So anything that was an animal outside, we treated as a priority one, so that meant immediate response from the officer within that area, and we were dealing with things accordingly to that. You mean any animal with those heats, that are going to be in distress. They're going to be getting impounded, they're going to be getting brought in. We've already had the conversations during that last little heat wave, and that'll be something else that we'll carry through easily throughout the summer to make sure that we're responding to those calls, at the level that they're really needed, because there's the case a little further north, with the lab that was on the third floor, and there were some complications with that. I've already spoke with a couple of our attorneys regarding that, so we could fully educate our officers as to what their legal authority would be in that scenario and how far they could go to getting that animal.
Ms. Wayne?
I talked once with an animal control officer. His opinion was that these people very seldom reform, these people who do these awful things in the first place. And he said they very seldom get any better, those people.
Certainly, and you mean there's a certain level of recidivism? You mean with any type of criminal activity?
Yeah, but they just don't reform. The education for those particular people doesn't work. They don't get anything. They don't improve their behavior.
So I know it's one of the things is, what was that?
My
name's Pat. No, I was trying to think about what your organization was. Thank you. I'm still learning. Please bear with me. It's a lot to take in. See, that would have helped tremendously. I know you folks have a program for after people have been convicted or
yes,
going
do.
Through.
Mm-hmm.
I know the county attorney's office have their diversion program. I know through the life skills.
Judge Felix sends a lot of people through those courses.
Certainly, and I know Life Skills had actually just contacted me yesterday because that's the actual diversion program from the attorney's office, and they're looking for ways that how we can kind of help them to get better educational components involved with that. So there is something in place to try to start dealing with those. Recidivism rates is what you're referring to. And one of the long-term goals for me, and I know I spoke at length with Jose about this, is real educational components targeting neighborhood within the communities that we seem appear to have the most common issues with, and going in there and whether it's dealing with having bring some of our officers that are fluent with Spanish to target certain communities. There's conversations that are already happening. Again, these aren't things that are going to happen overnight. There's other base things we have to work on within the department, and once we get some of those under control, we'll be able to push forward and do a lot more of these educational components. And I know this is something that, for me personally, is where what I want to work towards with this department.
Well, as the director for community outreach and education, I would be very happy to work with you guys. We come up with programs that we can do teaching at the Humane Society if it's mandated or if we get a ticket. There's different things that we can work on to do. Our educators are amazing, and they have a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're just amazing. So
absolutely.
I would be very happy to talk to you about.
Perfect. Any little component that we can do to really target? The two core areas on education will be. We're working a little bit on getting into some of the schools. We have another school thing coming up in a couple of weeks with one of our officers, in targeting some of the younger generations to get those educational components in, then also at the same time targeting people that have, you mean had minor animal law violations, you mean that there's a certain level that we're not going to try to educate, and hopefully the judicial process handles them appropriately. So you mean looking at two different ways to combat things. So I'll be more than open to sit down and having conversations, and we always end up at the same meetings anyways. So, you mean?
Driving me over.
Perfect.
So you're not under any limit of how many citations? The judges don't scold you if you give out too many citations, do they?
As far as I know, I spent the first 4 weeks I was here cross training, so it's like 2.5 weeks of actually within the position, and I'm still trying to learn, the inner workings of the department, working with the staff, figuring out some of those things, and figure out what's going to be the best steps, going forward to implement some of these change, so that way, it can be constructive and effective as we push forward.
Thank you.
Any other commentaries on
before you go, I have to take them, I'll have to say, I missed it on the citations. They were issued citations for the coyotes. On that one.
Oh.
I didn't mark it on the sheet. I will own up for that one.
Oh, okay.
So I know that was going to be one of your comments. So.
Yes, that's right.
Sure.
Time. And again, I emphasize that tie-ups are cruel. Animals suffer when kept on tie-ups. And also against the law. So since I wrote this, you actually did, or anyway, before I wrote it, you actually did give them citations for
yes,
tie-ups?
We did. Yes, that was my fault when I was looking at the citation form. There was two of them. So
okay.
I only saw what was actually the second one, which was on top, that only listed the shelter violations.
And let's see.
Did you say you only were five? Is that what you mean?
Five,
yes.
Yeah, five. Mm-hmm. And this, I think that here again, the bond law should have been used to take the animals away from these people. They had three of the dogs kept with no ventilation, and a puppy inside a shed with no insulation, and the windows were only cracked, and the puppy was the puppy was panting in an attempt to get some cooler air.
In Pima.
What?
In Pima.
Number.
Yes.
No, but weren't they at one of the yes, but they weren't. Wait a second. What happened? The owner was late, but they weren't bonded. Weren't the owners allowed to redeem the animals?
That part I do not know. That again, I'll add that to my notes to make sure when those little supplemental reports I get added in on the back end that we're documenting whether they're returned or not, so to make it easier for you folks to know where they are, because they're not, as far as I know, documented within these reports. These reports are generally, compiled without the activity reports that come through the mailing software system. So that's something that I can easily address with my officers. So when they are issuing citations, that we want disposition marked as far as what happened with the animals.
We have had over the last few years hundreds of cases where the dog was taken, Ms. Smith, Dr. Smith. The animals are taken and then the owners are allowed to redeem them. Hundreds of cases we've had like that. So just because it was taken doesn't mean that the owner didn't get it back. Well, going to number six, nobody has any other comments on number five. That this dog was in terrible shape, grossly underweight, massive tumor, nails abnormal, long, everything terrible. The owner was given 24 hours to get vet care. Did she get it?
The dog was euthanized the following day due to health issues.
Oh.
Not at PAC. She had obtained a private veterinarian herself.
She what?
She had her own veterinarian.
Who is that? Where the dog was euthanized?
Oh.
what happened? She has 24 hours to obtain vet care, so this terrible dog, this dog in horrible shape, she was allowed to keep.
Yes, and at that time, it was given 24 hours for the vet. She went to the vet within the required time from the officer that responded, and after going to that veterinarian, it was, you mean suggested by that vet to euthanize that animal?
Well, why was the owner allowed to keep this dog that was in horrible shape?
I mean, that was a decision that the officer made based off of, you mean, his belief that she was being willing and cooperative. And I would say that by her going to the vets the next day, that she was being cooperative. I mean, with, you mean, what was going on as part of that investigation. And then after speaking with that veterinarian, listen to what they suggested and euthanize that animal.
Well, she was still given citations. Was she still on the court?
Yes.
In cases like this, I kind of wonder, and we've gone round and round on this, and it's becoming the main focus point, at least of this committee. I'm sure it will be the next one, too. At what point, we've all been saying, when do we finally stop these people from owning animals? And there's plenty of laws that Shireen has brought up that can substantiate those types of decisions. So as you move to the next committee,
yes,
maybe you guys could keep that in mind and holding in that that's where we're headed. We're headed to try and stop, not just constantly citing these individuals or impounding their dogs, but try and keep dogs out of their hands. Because the only thing stopping dogs and cats from suffering is the good people in the community and the pack and the rest of them. So that would be another stopgap method is to stop those people.
Certainly, and again, you mean, I'll go back to some of the training components that we'll be looking into to change. I know when with Rona Kramer last month, you mean talking about the way the reports are getting put together is all the information there to support what you folks would like to see out of the prosecution. I go through, you mean, I look at these reports, and you mean, I see little things that I'd like to change that might be able to make these cases just a little bit stronger to be able to get those types of, you mean, decisions, dispositions from the courts that will be able to put, you mean, ultimately, if you want to prevent someone from having animals, having a court decide that they can't own animals for a period of time, having the ability then to use law enforcement or us as a enforcement agency to then go and do those searches, make sure they're not doing it. That way there's, you mean, a checks and balance system.
You mean, essentially, an affirmative defense.
Certainly.
In the sense that we take the position in the affirmative position to actually create a situation where those individuals have to do something to overturn what it is that you have said.
Certainly.
Through the courts.
Absolutely.
Mr. Newman, members of the committee, I think you can hear why we brought Ann on. But number two, I like this particular issue because I think that that's exactly what we're hoping that PAC 2.0 is about, that is looking at legal ordinances and solutions that can then be brought before the board that put more teeth where animal cruelty cases are concerned. So that we're hoping that in its next iteration that may be actually one of the major focuses, and we would anticipate and want the feedback of a lot of folks who are around this table still today, because you do have some expertise and some experience in this area as we move those things forward. But that's what I anticipate we'll be doing in the future.
Yes,
I would like to say that we talked about putting things on report. Thank you for whoever was responsible, or thank the officers for being more thorough in filling out some of this information, not leaving all these blank spots on the report, so we get a better idea of what's going on. And I know it's been a real beep every time I come in here and I say it's not pulled out right, and I like seeing it more complete. So please express my appreciation on this, because this was sort of easier, and I still have questions, but it was a lot easier.
Okay, very good.
Okay, thank you.
Well, one simple criterion is if the animal is in distress. Those are supposed to be taken away and bound.
Okay.
entire big laws in both the city and the county ordinances on animals in distress.
Yes, that's what I've been familiarizing myself with, but I believe I don't have it down as well as you do at this point.
Well, anyway, that's one of the criteria for taking an animal away.
Certainly, and again, with the bonding process, you mean, off the top of my head, you mean it doesn't say you shall or you must? You mean, again, there's still discretionary decision that's built into these ordinances to allow, you mean, anybody who's enforcing these laws to be able to make decisions? It's not a, you mean, written in the sense that it's 100% black and white. I mean, there's definitely variables and circumstances that have to be brought into the conversation.
Yes, of course, there's a lot of it is subjective, of course it is. It's not like...
Certainly.
It's not like arithmetic, and add two and two and add four.
And one of the things I've been trying to hope to convey, I mean, that there will be changes in the way that, I mean, we go forward and how we look at some of these cases. And you mean, but again, there will really never be like a black and white answer as this is the call, this is going to be the procedural response, because I think it's very important to be able to allow the officers to take in all the variables to make the decisions that they think is most appropriate. And then there is a point in time where other components haven't worked, where there has to be, you mean, a stiffer stance to deal with the situation that's currently going on.
Do the officers make that decision?
When they're on scene, yes. They're the ones that are, you mean, making the decision. I mean, there's other things at play. Sometimes they will pass the information across the supervisors. Historically, the supervisors have been more administrative and at the facility. This is another conversation that we have been working on and trying to figure out how to move forward to be able to get our supervisors back out in the field so they can be on scene assisting these officers to make more appropriate decisions, or to at least be able to put eyes on and to see what the entire scenario is, and then to be able to figure out what is going to be the best way for PEP to move forward and to make these decisions. I mean, there's a lot of conversations that are going on to address a lot of these issues, and it's one of those things. For me, I'm looking at a year from now to have some of these things in place. Like, it's going to be a slow process, unfortunately, but again, it's looking for those, short-term, then also those additional long-term goals, and making sure we're taking the appropriate steps to get there.
Any more on this particular, on number six? Any more discussion on number six? No? Okay. Is there any discussion?
Maybe stop one.
Pardon?
Maybe stop one. I was very disturbed when I read this case. There obviously is a history between the neighbors with the problem with the fence and the dogs. But what bothered me is that this gentleman stated that he came home about 8:15, and found his dog, Snickers, a 9-year-old male brown pit bull, and severely injured from wounds to the throat, neck, and head. He proceeded to take the dog to the vet, and the dog died from the wounds either at the vet or on the way. He went to the neighbor's house, and she admitted that she her dogs, and her dogs were responsible for the animals being attacked. Now, these dogs have been declared dangerous. However, that individual left a mortally injured animal in a yard without vet care. If that animal had received immediate vet care, it might have survived. And I would like to know why she was not, what was she providing for under the state statute. Because that is intentionally leaving an injured animal without vet care. And that's cruel.
So I won't be able to answer that for you because I don't have all the statutes and everything you mean perfectly memorized. You have a copy right there. So, if you want, under what point, under here, do you want me to look at?
Second item. I mean, you're leaving an animal. First of all, just common sense, so you get that animal in there. They can call Patrick, this is my dog's. Welcome to my neighbor, Shark. The dog's injured. I can't get to it. I need an officer out here for help. That could have done.
So, under, you mean section 2 here, section intentionally, two. Knowingly, or recklessly fails to provide medical attention necessary to prevent protracted suffering to any animal under the person's custody or control. that animal would not fall under her custody or control.
Even though her animals were the ones that were responsible for this?
It would not fit that, because that's not her animal, her property to be in control and custody. Again, it's not. I'm not saying that I believe her actions or what should have happened, but...
I don't totally agree with that, because if you do something to somebody, and you see that they're injured, or you see someone else injured by someone else, and you do nothing about it, should you do something about it?
I would hope that people with moral compass would say yes.
Okay, so in this particular case, her dog did this to some other dog. Actually, killed this other dog.
Yes.
Should she have a responsibility? Because I read that differently. Would she have a responsibility to, at a minimum, call the police, call PAC, call someone, and say that dog is suffering in that other yard? Because her dog did it.
So even again, at this time, I don't have all the information. I can look into it. I can talk with attorneys to see how they would interpret that. Again, I remember last month when Rona Kramer was here about the dog that was on the tie-out up over the fence. Again, that person had no responsibility to provide assistance to that dog.
But it wasn't them that created the dog jumping over. It's not like they threw
right.
the dog over.
It was certainly. Her animals that created the injury, and she was aware that her animals had a propensity to break the fence and get out. She was not proactive in maintaining that those animals be confined, and the fact that she left that injured animal there, that was reckless.
So, again, like I said, I can talk with our attorneys. Again, been here a very short period of time. I'm still trying to get my head wrapped around a lot of the differences? I'll even go out and say, back from where I come from, tie-outs are legal. They're not illegal. They have different shelter requirements and things of that nature. So, again, this is something that I can't speak to any great depth about, but what I can tell people of this board, that I will look into it, I will ask the questions of the people that can give us the clarification we need, and then if there is information there or they believe that there's something that could support, that's something that we can look at going forward.
If they determine that this cannot be acted upon because of her not being the owner and not being the property, I'm going to recommend that perhaps they need to look at the ordinance, or the local ordinance, and appendix so that it is covered. So in the future, that if somebody's dog does do harm, that there can be something punitive against the person, not just taking their dogs.
Certainly, and again, if there are any areas of interest, I understand you mean as far as with this board and whatnot, there's conversations we had as far as changes of ordinances that you feel would be more effective and then allow us to do the things that you would like to see of us, I hope that we would have the support of the board to help push those conversations forward and be able to make those things happen. Again, if there's something that's not there that we can adjust and make right to meet the needs of this board, we can look into it.
Just to FYI, a few years back, the state approved a new law. It's called dog liability, and it's called Fabian's Law because Fabian was attacked by somebody's dog. So, do you know if the officers would tell a victim that there is a law that allows them to sue civil about that?
That I would not know. If there's any way you can provide me with a copy of that, or at least a link to where I can get to that.
It's on my list. I'll pass it around. You can have it. I just wrote a note on there just to ignore my husband's doctor.
Okay.
Don't show up there.
Thanks.
Some of these laws, a lot of people don't know about them, and they're there, and if the officers know about that, they can advise the victim that, yes, this is your...
Certainly, they have some type of course of action through the civil proceeding. Certainly. But I don't think that goes as far as what you're looking for. But again, that is something I will, talk with our supervisors to see, what type of information that the officer has been trained to as far as to push this forward.
In my opinion, it's common sense. It's common sense, it's moral decency too. I'm sure that if the case was reversed, it should be offered.
Okay. Any other comments on Baker's Dog 1? No. Okay. Any other comments on any of the others?
Yes, sir.
And then you start four. For an excuse, this had to do with except three dogs that attacked a man. And by the way, for some reason, this was back on December 4th. I don't know why we're just getting it now. Or why it's just been attended to now. No, it was attended to back in December. But we're just getting it now.
Yes, and again, the dangerous dogs was actually provided to me through one of my field supervisors, and there was a slight, complication as far as why some information was in here and other pieces that were missing. Because if we look at dangerous dog number 4, we don't actually have any of the evaluation sheets to go along with it. Mm-hmm. Is that a place?
Mm-hmm. But it wasn't done until May. Right.
Okay. And again, one of the things that you may or may not have realized that with the enforcement unit, there is a considerable backlog of calls that officers are trying to work their way through. And so unfortunately, when priority calls are coming in, those become the first response that officers are going to. And there are older cases that are still trying to be remedied, gone through, make sure everything is happened the way that it needed to. And also in some circumstances, that someone might have came forward at a later date and then requested the dangerous dog assessment. It might not have been initially during that first part of the investigation. Those are some of the things that I've seen so far that could lead to such a delayed response. Because it's the same idea where, like, when we're doing citations, the person has up to a year to make that decision if they want citations to go forward. So that creates some of these, the time frame difference. But also at the same time, it's important to embrace the fact that there is a backlog. That we've been working our way through. We're almost at, I'd say we cut about 40% of it off at this point over the last month and a half. So we're working really, really hard and trying new ways to get through that so we can get to a manageable number of calls so we can be doing these things in a very timely, responsive manner.
What's also disturbing about this assistant officer stuff? One dog's not more important than the other, but the animal was attacked. Some of the actions relying on that animal to provide service.
Certainly, in any situation like that could disrupt that training and make that dog ineffective for the purpose that it was originally trained for. Certainly.
Anyway, this dog attacked a man and was given citations for it, and also. Bit a dog that belonged to the man. And there were three dogs. It says all the way here there were three dogs. But in the other pages here, it only has pages for two dogs. But anyway, it said I issued her third party citations on behalf for leash law. Biting animal attempt and biting animal dog on dog. This dog really did bite another dog. And I gave her citations for no license. For all three dogs. For no license. Well, I'll just talk about one of them. The one named, I can't read that,
Paloma.
It says here got a +2 for a break,
break in skin and bruising.
Yeah. And +2 for leash loss citation and +2 for another request for attempted bite citation, an animal attack, +3, because it really did bite another dog, and then +1 for attack without injury. And then on the right-hand column, which I believe should be eliminated, there's a plus five for inadequate fencing or gates, and a minus three for repairing the fence, which has nothing whatsoever to do with behavior, and then a minus five for getting licenses at minus one for getting licenses, and for each dog gets a minus one for that the owner got a license after an incident happened. And that should not be at all. Of course, a license has nothing to do with it, with behavior anyway, and I'm going to emphasize that this whole thing should be evaluated just on behavior. But if you're going to mention licenses, it should be the absence of a license when the attack occurred, not later on. And it clearly says that the owner had no licenses, or any three of them. And yet, on this sheet, this chart, it says that he did have a license. It's only because he got it afterwards.
Certainly. Dane, I know this was, again, it seems like the Danish dog thing has been a point of contention for, you mean, a period of time?
Many years.
Okay. A good portion over the last month since the last time the meeting was here. I am working on getting some information together to look at this. I hope when the trainer comes on board with Pat, this is something we will be able to sit down with that individual and to figure out, we have a trainer?
Yeah, behaviorist.
Behaviorist. So again, so once we have a behaviorist on, we'll be able to have conversations that has the educational background to really modify what this is. I will be honest that, there's certain aspects of this that I see as potential liabilities and things of that nature. So I'm not saying that this is great and wonderful. Is it something that we can evolve and adapt to be better suited to do what we're being asked to do through, ordinance? That we are the enforcement agency. So, one of our duties is to go forward and to do these evaluations, and when, they're required of us to do so. We're looking at a small snapshot of the amount of bites that actually occur in the course of a month. In the month of May, we had 229 reported animal bites to humans. So, there's a lot of things that are going on in to be doing some of these things. The amount of follow-up that goes into one of these dangerous dogs of evaluations for the investigators that have to go out there, check them with neighbors, they got to investigate with the owners, they got to talk with victims. We only currently have three investigators on staff right now. With the amount of bites that are going on, there's a lot of officers that are doing the preliminary calls. There's ways that we can be doing this better. And again, that's part of the bigger picture that we want to be working towards.
This is a classic case of the kind that I've been commenting on for, I think, maybe 3 years, Dr. Garcia. And I believe that I wish that you would do something about this complying with the laws. And this dog was not spayed or neutered, so that by declaring it not dangerous, you have left this very dangerous dog able to breed. The owner can breed it. The owner can breed this dog if he wants to, because you didn't declare it dangerous. And I've been bringing this up for at least 3 years. My opinion is that coming down in the right-hand column, everything should be eliminated except the minus points for when an animal is neutered or spayed. I would give the owner some minus points for that. All the others should be eliminated because they are not based on what the law says the criteria criteria should be, and I'll...
No, we're not going to, we've already heard that. We've already heard the law, based on, we moved it.
What, you mean you heard it last month?
I heard it every month.
Well, all we need to do is all read.
I'm not going to have you read the law to us now. You can make your points on what it is you did right now, but we're not going back into that law again.
All right, I can't make my point. The law says the behavior, the criterion should be based...
I just got them saying not to do that.
Well, I got the problem since I'm being kicked off anyway, I'm just...
The rest of us are going to move on. What is it, Jim?
I would like to share this with Adam. Mike Duffy is the Adam Cook Investigator for the Humane Society, and he's also the co-chair of the Adam Cook Task Force. And he recently returned from a conference in Florida, I think it was Orlando. It was a international forensic veterinarian something, something. And there's...
So was it Melinda Merck? Was that with Melinda Merck?
I don't know. There was many, many presentations. And he was telling me about one presentation that I thought was really, really interesting. And he said that the man, I don't have that information, who gave this topic, the title was, "Did the dog bite or was the person bitten?" And went on to describe, you know, the issues that we have in animal welfare and animal control. You know, was this a dog bite or did the person just get bitten? And I would highly recommend you to get a copy of that. I'd ask Mike to try and get a copy for you.
Certainly.
But I think that there could be a lot of information in there.
And absolutely. And again, I mean, as I've been looking through the dangerous animal ordinances, I've actually noticed an interesting discrepancy between, say, the city of Tucson to Pima County, because in the city of Tucson, provocation isn't listed under, I mean, the dangerous animal aspect. Whereas in the Pima County, if the animal is provoked, that there's, you mean, that's built in to be able to make some of those determinations as to how did this unfold. But it's interesting to see that underneath, you mean, where we're, you mean, have jurisdiction on different communities, that one of them does not include, you mean, that wording of provocation in it. So it really adds, you mean, a different component from us from the enforcement side to be able to say, well, okay, so now anytime this happens, whether the animal's provoked or not, do we have to go and conduct one of these dangerous animal assessments? Because it's not, you mean, again, they're worded very similar, but that word provocation is missing out of the city of Tucson, which would be another thing to be able to look at, mean amendment for an ordinance.
So when you go to reevaluate this tool,
certainly,
one of the things that bother me to that, we're talking about dog behavior, mm-hmm. just because a dog has lives in a fence, doesn't change its behavior.
Sure.
So I think that part of it, even though it may prevent the dog from attacking somebody, it doesn't really change the behavior of the dog.
Absolutely. And again, you mean there are other, you mean, jurisdictions across the country that when an animal is, you mean, assessed and going through like a dangerous dog, that they're required to have, you mean, a behavioral assessment conducted by someone who is educated in being able to do that. You mean, again, when these officers are going out and they're doing a minimal behavioral assessment, you mean, what is their training knowledge to be able to be doing some of these assessments? And again, that's another component of, you mean, the conversation as to where we'd like to take the department. And again, by having the behaviors on, you mean, active, you mean, staff, that's going to be able to help push us forward, you mean, in a lot of good ways to be able to address some of these concerns, and whether that's something else that you have to look into to get added in as part of the process to be able to give, I mean, somebody that has the education that can put it into a scientific, you mean, point of view to be able to say, is this a, you mean, what type of aggression is this? You mean, again, you mean, whether it's fear aggression, you mean, possession aggression, you mean, there's a lot of different things. I mean, I have a background of working with working dogs and protection dogs, and they'll all hit you on command, but they're friendly, easygoing, lovely dogs. So again, you mean there's different components that go towards these behaviors. So again, as we push forward, these are the conversations. And you mean anybody who is, you mean, no longer going to be with the board after, you mean, tonight, you mean, if you are still interested, you mean, I can give everybody an email address. I'm still open to what suggestions that you folks have, because you've been doing this for a very long period of time. I've been here for a short period of time. The more information I have, the, you mean, better decisions I can make for the department, I mean, going forward.
Last time we were talking about the dangerous dog assessment process, I asked, even though I was not going to be on the next committee, that I be kept in the loop, because I would like to have some input The other thing here is, what do you define as an injury? If your officer had read this report, it does say the dog was injured, as was the man.
Yes.
It says here, attack with no injury.
Certainly.
There's another one that says injuries treated by owner. And I would say as a minor body treated by owner, that rates a 2, not a plus 1. Mm-hmm. And then again, they were given points for getting a license after the fact, but it wasn't negated by having a plus 1 by not having a license.
And certainly.
If this was done, Paloma would have been declared dangerous.
Certainly. And again, and this is where this, the current assessment becomes subjective in nature. There's another one. Which one? It was. If you guys go to dangerous dog number 2, I mean, on the assessment, it says violation by +6, +6. Mm-hmm. You mean that's a subjective thing, because the way the thing's set up to be scored is you only allowed 1 +6. Mm-hmm. You mean, so again, this is something that you mean I've been looking at, I mean, trying to evaluate and try to figure out what's the best way going forward. And if you look at this dog got a 36. Mm-hmm. Even without the extra 6 and the extra ones that were added in, this dog was deemed dangerous. You mean, there's no questions asked. So again, we have to look at this. You mean, I know this was a point of contention at the last meeting for my first time being here. You mean, I've been taking the time to look at it. I'm looking at some of our statistic database to be able to look at it and say, okay, you mean, how many bites we have and how many are going to fall into violation, how many are not violations? Do we have a way to even track that data to be able to push forward? I mean, like I said, about having a behaviorist, you mean, there's a lot of conversation. I have a background in dog training, working in shelters and doing, you mean, enrichment programs. So, you mean, I have decent base knowledge, but again, we have the ability to have somebody else coming in that, I mean, their education background is going to be far more significant, and that's when we'll be able to look into this to make some of those decisions.
Okay. Thank you. We're done with the dangerous dogs. We're now moving to the old business, which is first on the list, a shortening of shelter animals' length of stay.
So that continues, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, that continues to be an ongoing kind of challenge for us, and we will continue to work on that. I was going to sort of touch on it in my manager's report, so I will ask your forbearance to talk about it there in a little bit more detail.
Okay. All right, and the other old business was the...
Excuse me.
Yes, ma'am.
I have some things to say about the holes.
About the holes?
Yes.
No, we just addressed it. We're moving on now.
So you're not allowing me to speak?
That's correct. No, I'm on that issue. The issue is going to be addressed by Dr. Garcia. He addressed it. He's going to address it further in his presentation. The proposed Pima County Animal Care Advisory Committee management reports.
I asked for that. We used to get reports in our packets based on the activities, like how many animals we received, how many were adopted, whether they were from the city or the county.
Oh, yeah.
And you were going to look into that and see if we can bring those back.
And those are definitely pieces that we're trying to figure out what, and that will also be part of what I'd like to talk about in the management report are precisely how we do some of these things, both with regards to the holds, with regards to management reports that you guys are getting. Because I think that one of the things that we need to do a better job as staff is giving you information that is both actionable and strategic. And I think that we could, potentially spend hours and hours and hours reviewing a lot of details, but if we're not making strategic progress toward our goal, whether it be in the animal cruelty, whether it be in the adoption area, I think we will have failed. The reason to review this information is to make progress. And so that's what I'm hoping that we can get to.
Well, for me, that makes a lot of sense, because just like with the dangerous dogs or every single issue, there's underlying criteria in which the department is going to be making changes. So we could go through each one and go through 1,000, they're all the same. That was the answer that you gave, was the same many times over, that I'm looking at it, and we're working at it, we're changing it, and we're going to come up with a complete change. So that's what, I guess we're looking at the same thing with the holds as well, because you can have 1,000 dogs at 5 days, and then 10 dogs for a year.
And Mr. Chairman and members of the advisory committee, I think at the end of the day, the part of what we have to figure out is how do we create the most benefit for the greatest number of animals in this community. At the end of the day, the animal is our customer. Animals in this community are our customers. At the end of the day, their owners are part of that customer base. And we need to figure out how to get that. And we need to figure out how to get that done. And I think that we can, you know, go through cases ad nauseum and still miss that strategic goal. And that's what I'm hoping that we don't do.
Thank you. Excuse me, should we have quiet during the presentation?
So I'm going to, if it's okay with you,
yes.
And the committee, I'm just going to go through the manager's report. There's a few different components for this. The other thing I wanted to sort of say to the gallery is that we have brought some food and refreshments, and please help yourselves because we want you to have some food and refreshments. Part of the reason we did that is because we really want to acknowledge and thank and recognize the very, very important impact that this advisory committee has had on the workings of PAC. We would not be at PAC where we are today had it not been for the people that are around this table. And I believe that in my heart of hearts that we are about to make a leap forward from that, but it's only possible because of the foundation that has been laid, and I'm deeply thankful to you. I wanted to do a couple of things, and one of them is kind of do a brief review of our achievements as the advisory committee, what the advisory committee has accomplished during the last few years. I'm going to ask my colleague and friend Jose Ocaño, who's our essentially our co-director out there, to come up and do that. Then what I want to do is I will talk about what I'm calling PAC Act 2.2. I'm sorry, 2.0, which is what the organization looks like afterwards. What are the pieces here that need to be informed by you? Number three, I want to tell you a little bit about our building and where we are with that. And finally, one of the things that I promised both the chair and one of the other members of the committee that I would do is give you an update on where we are in our volunteer program assessment. So, do you want to come up? Is it working?
You guys want me to, do you want me to sit here or do you want me to stand? You'll be, oh, are you my assistant today?
I'm your assistant.
How did this turn? All right, good evening, everybody. I'm really excited to talk about this because I have actually been at PAC a decade this year. So a lot of this I have seen, and I've really long-standing relationships with many people on this committee. So I'm really proud of what you guys have set for foundation, what we've kind of done together. So this is just some basic background. I think most people understand this. You know, I was giving a tour today of the shelter. It was built in 1969. It was really built to house animals and to kill them, quite frankly. It was not built to do life-saving measures. And so when it was also built, it was not built with 1 million people in our community. So the shelter, while it's remained the same, the community has really shifted. And you'll see that, especially in the last 10 years, how that's happened. We're one of the largest counties in the country. So one of the things when we're talking about enforcement, you know, we have on any given time four enforcement officers out at any given time covering 9,400 square miles. So it is a lot. The shelter and PAC has really expanded to have shelter, clinic licensing, enforcement, dispatch, administration. And something that I forgot to add in here is live release, because live release was something that was never something we focused on, and that's our volunteer department, our rescue department, our adoption department, and our volunteer department. And our budget has grown substantially to $8.9 million, and we've grown to 91 employees, and we take in currently 20,000 animals every year. 2007, I was just a puppy when I walked in, all bright-eyed, ready to take on the world. We had 22,000, or our intake was 22,000. You'll see kind of in this presentation how intake goes up and down, and you'll see a little note here at Humane Society, because we are partners in this community, so whenever one of us does anything differently, it affects the other. So even in 2007, our intake wasn't that much higher than what it is right now. But what is very different is that live release rate of 39%. And so each year, we were trying to go through and look at what is something substantial that happened every single year. Well, I remember when I first started that pack, any pit bull bully breed dog that was over the age of 3 months was automatically euthanized. I actually found the old policy book the other day when I was cleaning stuff out in the move. And I remember that was something that didn't settle right with me. I think that was something that didn't settle right with a lot of members on this committee, and that was something that changed that year. And that was really big. I still interface people on a regular basis who think that that's what we do, and I'm like, just look at our adoption floor. They're all up for adoption. So in 2008, you know, we have a recession, starts to begin, so a lot more owner surrenders, so intake goes up to 27,000 animals. But you'll see the live release rate, even with more animals, more are being saved, and that's a direct correlation to placing pit bull breeding type dogs for adoption. It was also nice that we all didn't have to lie and call things lab faces anymore. Maybe it. And one thing that was really big this year is they created a position of a treatment technician. What you'll see in the theme in this presentation too is that with every new position, that's when things really change. And so for the longest time, we didn't have anyone that was really dedicated to just focusing on triaging and treating the animals. And even in 2008, that was really bare bones, minimal treatment. Tammy can probably remember those days of rescuing. It was treatment meant, hey, we're gonna give you doxycycline for 2 days. But that was better than giving it no doxycycline and not giving it a chance to be rescued. And that's when we started to shift with that position. It really changed things. So in 2008, 2009, a little bit more intake, live release rate, still similar to the last one. But what really changed here was the position of, well, Justin's position when he first came from the Humane Society, who was the animal care advocate. We had never had a position that was there, even in the title, advocate for the animals. That was very, very different. That really started a cultural shift. It came with a lot of resistance. You know, anytime you have change, I think, in a government shelter, you're going to have people who aren't comfortable with all the things we're asking them to do. And that sometimes is because the shame of feeling like what they've been doing is wrong. And while there's a better way to do it, we've always had to be really smart and sensitive about implementing that change. So when Justin first started, I remember a lot of those conversations in here too. We were like, we still need more support. And at the time, we had about maybe 5 or 6 rescue groups. Fair was one of them, Cold with Noses, ARF, Safe, those kinds of the big groups pulling the vast majority of our animals. But we never had someone who could really just focus their time on expanding the program, working with the rescues to support them. So that was something that they did. Because initially, that's what Justin was going to do. But then they were like, you manage a shelter. Humane Society manages a shelter too. So that's when they realized he needed some more support with that. And we used to rescue out about 500 animals a year, and that went to 2,000 animals that first year, just by registering more rescue partners and making the process to rescue an animal easier. And that really came back to the special needs adoption program. For many years, it was thought only this small group of rescuers are qualified to take an animal. And at this time, we're not talking about animals with cancer, all the double dogs, Dupree, those kinds of dogs automatically didn't have a chance. We were just talking about like simple kennel cough. So there was lots of conversations, again, a lot of those happened here, where we talked about, could someone from the public come in and do a special needs adoption? And can we trust in them and work with them and follow up with them that they're gonna do the right thing? And that was kind of where the special needs adoption program started in 2009, and since then it's probably one of our most successful programs, and it's key in life saving. 2010, intake goes up. Around this time, Humane Society starts following a lot of the best practices in the country, which is manage intake and being strategic with their resources. So naturally, we saw a spike in intake at our shelter. With that spike, the live release rate actually went down slightly. Some of the things that really changed here, and this is some stuff that I was really proud of, was the inmate program. So anyone who remembers, and I remember, again, a lot of this stuff was talked about here, was animals were sprayed, dogs were sprayed in their kennels. They were never taken out to be cleaned. And so we saw an opportunity to better that process. So we had male inmates, or no, actually female inmates at first. Mm-hmm. And so we started to change the way we disinfected and treated the animals. And that was actually huge because, as we all know now, disinfection in the shelter is fundamental in everything we do. And it was the last thing in our mind. We also started to treat URI, which is, sounds small, but it was a really big deal when we were met with a lot of different kinds of reasons why we could not ever treat an animal for URI. They're sick, it's not going to really get better. Shelter medicine is something that has really evolved, so there wasn't a whole lot of information that, like we have now, that says, yes, you can and you should treat in a shelter. So that, you know where the puppy room is, that I remember we finally were given 16 half kennels to hold them. And again, it wasn't treating for their whole treatment course, it was starting off with 3 days. And then little by little, we started to ask for more treatment and we started to treat more. And this is 2010, really was when we started to get the right people in, because as we changed, as we became more focused on following best practice, saving animals, treating animals, we could attract the right kind of people who actually wanted to work and stay at the shelter. I think that, like, a lot of our staff that we have now, we started getting in 2010, there's no way they would have stayed and been able to stay in 2006 or 2007. So in 2011, our intake starts to go down, our live release rate goes up, so this is a common theme. And it was the first time Pet Finder Foundation, it was the first national foundation to ever give us a grant. And that was a grant to bring on a trainer full-time and work with volunteers in the Train to Adopt program. And so it was the first of many things of that we kind of start to realize, wow, if we do things properly with best practice, there's these other organizations who want to give you money, because we were always under the impression that only humane societies were eligible for those kinds of dollars. And as you can see where we are now, that is far from the truth. 2012. This is pretty cool. So our intake starts to go down some more, like the release rate goes up. One of the things that came out of PACAC was really focused. There was a time where rescue was a really heavily topic, and how can we make it easier for rescues? For many years, it was a dog would go up for adoption or a cat would go up for adoption, and would have to sit through a Sunday before it had ever be able to be pulled by rescue. Even just simply saying, the second an animal is available, rescue can take it. And then it went even further and said, even if the animal is on stray hold, rescue can take it. They will sign here that if the owner comes forward, they're going to release the animal back to the owner. Most rescues didn't want to take on that liability, but it really showed kind of how the culture changed in terms of not being like holding on to our animals too tightly. And this is where Mr. Newman and Kathy started a lot with the dog walks. I remember when I came back from Florida and they told me, there's this guy and he wants to do these walks where the people just show up and you give them a dog, and I'm like, that guy is there is no way that this works. Every dog is going to fight. People are going to steal dogs. And I showed up when I wasn't even hired yet to come back. And I just came to help. And it really, really works. We have great success. And I think this is where the community started to look at our shelter differently. Because you had people who were never engaged coming in the hundreds, seeing that this is not that bad of a place. Or they saw, wow, I really want to help and get involved. So as we kind of started talking about a new volunteer program this year in 2012, we utilized these walks really strategically to get a whole new group of people in the door. We started thinking about we could really fundraise, because people were coming and we didn't even ask for donations all the time, and they would just bring tons of donations, and we're like, there's something to this. People want to help, because I think we always thought we were cute, but decided no one wants anything to do with us. We're just here alone. And it was for the first time, at least for me, and I think in a lot of stuff, we realized we're really not in this alone. And people really want to do something to help us and these animals. So in 2013, live release rate, I'll never forget when we hit 70s. That was a big deal to hit the 70s. And our intake started to go down. That's when we created a whole volunteer coordinator position. I think through that, we realized the value in volunteers and that we we'll likely never have the kind of staffing we need to cover all of our bases. We'll never have staff to walk the dogs and do all of these things that is actually critical in helping their sociability, especially in adoptions. So when this position started, we had about 95 volunteers. And within that first year, it went to 600. And everything changed. The way we did adoption changed. The way we walked the dogs. We launched lots of different programs. So many of our life-saving programs were from people coming to an advisory committee, volunteers from the advisory committee saying, let me try this, whether that's our socialization program, whether that was changing our adoption program. And then we did, for a period, have Pima Possible Life. We launched a program where we were treating animals off-site for about a year and a half. And that was really different because it did, for a period of time, give us some breathing room to not have sick animals at the shelter being treated. I've always seen 2014 is like the year where all the progress, like we're making strides, you can see every year, but then we push like the fast forward button on 2014. And a lot of that happened in this conference, well, not this one, the one that is currently in two pieces at the shelter. Live release rate higher, intake slightly lower, but what happened was there was conversation of the overcrowding. There was too many animals in a kennel. It was inhumane. But the answer wasn't euthanasia, which typically that was the answer for the last whole history of PAC. So we erected this beautiful tent. And while it gives me an ulcer, it has also been the key tool in saving lives. Like, I can't imagine what life would be like with that 150 dogs down below. It just wouldn't be possible to be where we are. But the key thing was, all of these positions that came in that packet. Six animal care technicians. I just think about, for the longest time, intake was one person and you're just getting name, phone number. You're not getting animal history, you're getting minimal information, and that can make or break an animal's life. So it changed the way we were able to do our intake processes. It changed where we could actually start to put staff. For the first time, we could actually have a staff dedicated in adoptions. And while that's something we want to grow, for the longest time, there was no one in adoptions other than our volunteers. Having a dedicated shelter manager allowed us to really fine-tune a lot of those processes. I think for many years, the conversation in here was very shelter-focused in regards to the animals weren't getting the kind of vet care they needed or they weren't being housed properly. And so I think all of those conversations manifested in a shelter manager and our ability to collectively, even in here, it was not always the easiest thing, right, in here, but I see where we are now. And it's a much, much different shelter than it even was when we first started this program in 2014. And then there is my savior, Dr. Wilcox. She's changed that place. You know, I remember our first day coming in and I was like, we're just doing HR paperwork. And she sees a dog and it's injured and she just starts pulling antibiotics out of her pocket and pain meds. And I'm like, well, this is not going to happen the way I thought. It was really quickly we learned, okay, and now we all know Wilcox, she's very boots on the ground kind of girl. And so that's amazing. We completely changed the philosophies of what we do, how we do, what we treat. When I say expanded treatable, she blew the roof off of what is treatable. And every day, she's changed my own perceptions on what I thought was treatable. If anything, sometimes I see things, it's like, maybe you're going a little too far, you know? But we are really pushing the envelope. And then having a dedicated foster coordinator. For many years, it's a liability. The county can't have a foster coordinator. You can't have a foster program. Well, that wasn't true. And now thousands of animals' lives have been saved through the foster program. And then we got our money maker, Karen Hollish. And she was great because she was a pet finder employee. And she had experience working at the Humane Society. And she really came in and she flipped the script on developing money in a shelter. A lot of people are reluctant to give to the shelter, but she's managed to bring in millions of dollars. And that's a lot of that is because of the change that was advocated in here. No one's going to donate money to a shelter that's killing all of their animals or that is cleaning kennels where they're being sprayed inside. So all of that changed a lot with that position. Keep snowing. This was key, because this has been instrumental in increasing our intake to go down. PACAC recommended that the funding for screening year go up to $600,000, and which is the job. Let's get up more. So that was really great for the community just to have an extra resource and more resources. The reservation process, you know, for the longest time it was you have to wait until an animal was up for adoption, and now we're even seeing it's called open selection, and our new shelter is actually being built around open selection where animals that are appropriate to go up to that are going to be adopted, there's a process called fast tracking and everything where you want to put even animals on stray and make them, put them in key places so that they can get adopted so that at the end of their stray hold, they're gone that next day, as opposed to waiting every day in a shelter counts. Every single day matters. And so the reservation process changed. And I mean, that's something you'll see many of you where I'm sure we'll all be involved with see emails from me how we're going to expand that. And then pre-altering the animals. For many years, as you came in, none of the animals weren't altered until you actually adopted them. It's a big, people want to leave with an animal. That is just the nature of our kind of consumer-minded society nowadays. You want everything right now. And so, and I feel like that was something that was really smart to just go in and say, all right, the majority of our animals can go home. And I think that really helps animals get adopted. With requests to euthanasias, for many years you never contested it. It was the person came in and they wanted it and you did it. And I've heard and experienced many horror stories because there are things like convenience euthanasias. And so now we check everything beforehand. So it still has to be signed off by our staff before that happens. And about 20 to 25% of animals that are booked in a euthanasia request are actually rehabilitated and readopted out. That still says the majority are warranted. The majority actually are there. The owners are correct in their assertion that it's time. But we don't do convenience euthanasias anymore. With the ASPCA challenge, you know, that was a fun summer, stressful. Because most people have marketing, you know, people at their shelter, and they have money dedicated for all of the cats. Like, yes, you do have money for that. We didn't. We went in with a lot of heart and a lot of volunteer participation, and we were like number 6 in the nation and number 1 in Arizona. Like, that was pretty incredible to adopt that lost animals. Even, and again, evolving our philosophies, FIV positive cats being placed up for adoption. For the longest time, cats with FIV shouldn't be placed up for adoption, they should be euthanized. There's all these thoughts that are really old school. With new information, when you know better, you do better, you know? And then the community cats projects, talk about flipping the switch on cats. I never thought I'd see a day where cats had a better possibility of a live outcome than a dog. I did not know or think that that was possible. And that is the fact that now TNR has transformed the shelter, it's transformed the community. I was in our impound room today, and it was like half empty. Oh my God. An impound is coming, I can feel it. Don't do that. So we have increased the amount of cats getting adopted. We're putting cats back out where they should go. The amount of cats in our shelter has decreased. We're able to put more resources on cats that are scared and actually really need that extra time. So it did exactly what it was supposed to do. But if anything was a highlight of 415, it was Proposition 415. And that, I know tons of people in this room. And I know there was a lot of things there was, you're never going to get it put on the bond. And it was, and if you get it even standalone, it's never going to be passed. And it did. And that sets us up to change the way we do business in the future. Now our shelter can match our operation, and it will be a lot more seamless of a process. So in 2015 was the first time we hit 90%. Crazy. I remember, I kept writing the numbers. I'm like, no, that can't be right. That cannot be happening. Our intake hit 20,000, which is the lowest historically it's ever been. And that's spay neutering. That's all of these other kinds of components. And again, we're attracting donors who actually, for the first time, donated a substantial amount of money for us to hire part-time employees. It's the first time that's ever happened. Normally, the donations go to medical, they go to spay neuter. This person said, I want you to hire cat care needs, and I want to fund a health desk, a diversion program. And that was really neat. Marcy was really helpful, and still is in a lot of that process. And it kind of set the stage for what we'll be doing this year with a new program we're going to launch. And with the expansion of 4 PetSmart locations and hiring on an actual staff that can just do, if anyone's met Mark, he's really good at off-site adoption.
Yeah, I've met Mark.
I didn't mention this here is our history of stealing Humane Society staff. Yes. But every time you see an extra staff, it's probably someone that came from the Humane Society that has room for us that I'd like to thank. And so we expanded our PetSmart rotations. That's especially instrumental with the cats, having cats being able to be off-site and their cages are clean, the adoptions are done by PetSmart staff, sometimes our volunteers. It's been really instrumental in decreasing the amount of cats we have in our shelter. And then we started looking at what we had. For the longest time, the way our medical clinic was, it didn't make a lot of sense. And I think we heard lots of frustration in here about how contracted vets and all the money that was going to contracted vets for a really small amount of time. So we changed all that, we took all that feedback, and then we hired Dr. Rios and Dr. Carlson. And those three are probably the best medical team, one of the best in the country. We are super lucky to have. And Michelle, who doesn't get enough credit, she's kind of the backbone. She runs the ship. So this year, lots of changes. Our barn cat program, so we did TNR, that was huge. And now it's about, now I have all of these cats with no outdoor history. They're not the most friendliest. How do we save them? And so barn cat program started to become something that there was a lot of research going into and something that was really popular. It really blew up when the Huffington Post did a whole kind of article about it. And so that's been really, really key. And now our cat care leads are focusing on our barn cat program. We relaunched our foster care program in just this year. The amount of cats that are going through the foster program specifically, because that's what we see a lot of, has increased like 30%, which is really great. And I'm here now in this capacity. So we reorganized the leadership. We include two division managers with me and Justin, and we broke ground on, not necessarily on our actual facility, but the archaeology and moving everything that has all happened and is happening. Something that's exciting for July is our hold times. You know, having long base hold on times is not a good practice anymore. And I know that's something that was discussed here as well. So now instead of having to hold an animal 7 days that is an owner animal, it's going down to 5 days starting in July. And as we can see from today, a lot of the conversation has been enforcement focused, you know. And I think what we've had to do is look at there's lots of fires all the time. And in terms of like the organization, it was okay, let's get the shelter and medical. We need to get that together first. And that's taken years to do all that. And now that that is more stable, it is time to look at our enforcement and really scrub it, fine tune it. And so having had him on board, even today, seeing the dynamic and how it was so different from even last month. So we're really excited for something, but again, remember the shelter didn't transform. First day Wilcox started, but now we're able to look back 2 years later and see the collective, you know, work that everyone has put together. And we're going to launch our pet support center, giving people actual resources to keep their animals. A lot of times when people show up to that intake lobby, they've emotionally disconnected. And they, even if you can offer them something, they're not interested. But if you can get them on the phone before they come in, you can have a lot of success with helping them keep that animal or help them find other solutions. So that's exciting. And the trainer, I think we can all agree, like we've made strides with medical, but what's left to be done is behavior and behavior dogs. That is where we have a lot of work to do. STR, all of those things is gonna be the focus on how do we eliminate STR? You know, that's something that we're gonna be talking to this trainer about. And so I really think that I look at today when I was looking at this presentation, and I don't realize how far we've come because I'm either too focused on where we need to be, but this was really neat, and I hope everyone here can really kind of take a pause and be like, I'm so grateful, so much of the staff is grateful for what you've done because you've really kind of helped us get to where we are, and it's been a long 10 years. And the next few years, I think, will be even better. So that's kind of us in a nutshell. Thank you guys for what you guys have done. All right.
When I joined the county in January 2013, the second week on the job was going to engaging with the PAW, one of our Pima Animal Welfare Alliance, Alliance for Animal Welfare, I should get that right. And I, at the time, and quite honestly, I still feel like I had no knowledge of pets. I really never had pets before, And I couldn't understand how this sort of fit in within the portfolio of responsibilities that I had been given. And so for me, it's been a really steep learning curve. And I've leaned on a lot of people on this committee. Jack has been the chairman, has been a very sort of important source of knowledge and support for me, as Pat and Tammy and Nancy, all of whom have at different times sort of cornered me and said, you need to be thinking about these things. And I really appreciate the history, Dr. Kwasniak, Ms. Shireen, and Ms. Eptich, all of whom have been with this group for a heck of a long time. And so the wisdom has percolated. I know it doesn't always feel like it has, but it really has percolated. I certainly have learned a tremendous amount from that process. So that was part of what we wanted to sort of convey to you today, that we've actually heard, that we know that your hearts are in the right place, and we know that your advice comes from a good place, and we're trying to extract the bigger strategic guidance that you're giving us from the details that you're sharing. So I wanted to talk a little bit about PAC Act 2.0 and talk about how I'm sort of envisioning some of this going. Now each group that is assembled will sort of come up with its own sort of way of doing things, and we are not pre-baking any of this. But one of the things that we have talked about, and one of the things that the county administrator has asked for, is strategic guidance versus operational guidance. And the enforcement of animal cruelty laws, and the actually kind of limited kinds of things that we can do today are things that have a political solution. And the question is, when do we start crafting new laws? When do we start crafting new ordinance to really reflect, in the same way that we modernize our operations, that really reflect a modern way of thinking about companion animals in our community? And we really see that as being one of the goals that we have for PAC Act, to really think about it at that strategic level. Because honestly, as staff, I'm not going to suggest new ordinances. That needs to come from the community. That needs to come from the advisory committee. Because anything that I do, anything that my staff does, will be seen as self-serving. And so at the end of the day, the only way to move this agenda forward is to have folks think about it critically. One of the pieces that we want to do, because we know that people like Nancy, that people like Ms. Green, that people like Pat actually look at the stuff that we produce in painful and excruciating detail, we want to be able to continue to honor some of that. And so we have proposed to develop management reports that would be produced on different topics. And those topics would be covered once a year in great depth. Those management reports would be presented to the new advisory committee, who would have to sort of concur and agree and study them. And then we would actually put them out into the ether. We would put them out for the public to scrutinize. Because I think at the end of the day, what we need to do as an agency is be as transparent as possible, and as responsible, and really when the darn bond passed, I all of a sudden felt a hell of a lot more responsibility on my shoulders in terms of being able to demonstrate the value, especially when we saw the subsequent bond go down in flames. So we really feel like we have an affirmative responsibility both to provide insight into what we're doing with the public dollar, but also providing that strategic guidance. So here's a list of the different topics that would be the management reports that would be produced. This would not be done every single month. These would be produced once a year. And again, it would be deliberated, it would be discussed at the meeting, and would be informed by that discussion. And so these are the topic areas. And one of the things that I'm hoping that you are able to tell me today is, are we missing things from this? These items, these topic areas, have actually come out of the discussions where we have sat all around the room and said, these are the kinds of things that I'm really interested in. So this will permit us to do a deep dive into the volunteer program. We know we can't function without the volunteer program. We know we can't function without it, and so we need to sort of figure out how to optimize it, how to be transparent about it, how to report back on our progress or lack thereof in one fell swoop. Enforcement, obviously, is an area that draws a lot of attention for a good reason, and as our standards as a community and our expectations for how we care for companion animals change, I think we're going to need to be able to tell a really good story. For instance, the dangerous dog assessment. Why is it that it is crafted in the way that it is? And the question becomes, do we just tinker around at the edges by eliminating a category here or a scoring system there, or do we have to start from scratch? Are there best practice models that we could look at from other communities? The whole concept of animal court, a court that would be set up to resolve these kinds of issues, those are the kinds of things that we want to make sure that the next version of PACAC has an opportunity to opine on, to give us guidance on, because there will be some political heavy lifting that will have to go along with those kinds of things. That would resolve cases very quickly, that would be very animal-focused, animal-welfare-focused. You know, those are solutions. The adoption and rescue programs, I turned to Marcy because I remember telling Marcy once, Marcy, I don't know if we can ever be a no-kill shelter. I think we could strive to be a no-kill community, but I don't know that I can get there. And she pushed back. And I'm actually thinking that we are probably well on our way there. And have I personally changed my mind a lot about that particular issue. I'll tell you, I still get beat up a lot by our partner jurisdictions. I will still get beat up by a lot of people for even suggesting that is even something that we should be thinking about. But thinking through our adoption and rescue programs and how they fit with each other, I think, becomes really essential. Shelter operations, this one's going to be a very technical report that looks at how we operate our shelter, what we're doing in terms of disease control, what we're doing in terms of behavioral management, what we're doing in that area. Probably very few people will want to read it, but I guarantee you that this is how we continue to improve the quality of life for the animals that are in our care, by decreasing their length of stay and by increasing the quality of their sheltering with us. The clinical program, again, for a lot of obvious reasons, because this is where the feel-good stuff comes from, because this is where the stories will come from, we feel like, and quite honestly, because we're the only shelter, we're the only municipal or government animal welfare agency that has this large of a veterinary staff, I really feel like I better show my boss and I better show the taxpayers of Pima County that there's a good reason why we have three veterinarians. Again, that's an issue that I continue to get beat up on, but I continue to believe that this is the right decision to go down. So I think that we'll need to continue to be able to do this and try to figure out how we work with the new veterinary program at the University of Arizona, and how we continue to partner in positive ways with our veterinary community, because they are absolutely essential, and we want to make sure that the things that we do in our facility do not end up threatening and do not end up detracting from the work that they do, because we need them to be operational. The development program, as we acquire more assets from people, as people are share so generously with us, again, we feel a real obligation to really be transparent about that. And that's not just reporting on dollars that have been donated, but really seeing what is the impact of those dollars. And Pat, your agency has a lot of depth and experience with that, but this is a completely new muscle for us. There is nowhere else in the county that has as as a highly productive, in terms of donations, development program. The only thing that comes close is that the libraries have a Friends of the Library kind of thing. They don't raise nearly as much money as we do. So I really feel like we have a very critical responsibility for transparency to our donors and to our citizens. And then finally, the budget, because at the end of the day, as Jack once commented, you know, your values are reflected in the way that you allocate resources. And again, here's an area where we have had a significant growth in our budget, just trying to catch up, quite honestly. I've been accused of trying to build cat condos, cheap condos. I've been accused of neglecting developing clinical services for children at the expense of building facilities for animals. I really think that finally we are getting close to being close to the right size in terms of our budget. But what that means, though, is that we need to be showing you what the impact of those budget expenditures are. And we also, this is a place where the strategic decisions and input that PACAC gives can really shape. One of the comments that this advisory committee has made in the last year has been that we need to beef up our enforcement. Part of beefing up that enforcement was bringing in somebody who is just a rock star. Part of beefing up that enforcement has to be how we thinking about how we staff that area beyond that, beyond the leadership. So those things all have budgetary implications. You rob Peter to pay Paul, so what is the right formula? And that's what we will be looking to you for. We do not have a set of bylaws. We have not done that because we think that the new group needs to do that for themselves. But the issues of how often should the groups be meeting, what a forum looks like, and also how one of the key things that the advisory committee does is it advises not so much the staff and operation, but really the policymakers, and how can we continue to do that? And I think PACAC has been really strategic at times in the kinds of things that it has communicated to the board, and I think we've seen some good results because of that. But in terms of the meeting frequency, time, location, all those things are going to be up for grabs, and thinking about what is the best way of engaging community. Are there other ways of engaging community? Because not everyone's going to have a chance to be at the gallery and to listen to the discussion. But there are plenty of people in our community that care about animals and that want to have an opinion to express that concern. So that was what I had for PACAC and for where I see the future reports that really kind of drill down in some great detail in terms of the work that we do. I wanted to tell you a little bit about our building updates. I can report today to you that we are on target in terms of our timing for moving into our facility by the end of 2017.
Middle of 2017.
I'm sorry.
Oh wait.
No.
Say phase one.
No. Phase one. Yes. At the end of 2017, December 2017, we are on target to have completed phase one. Phase one is the component that has isolation, it has the clinical areas for animals, that has the outdoor, indoor kenneling, is more than half of the project. Phase two would be mid-2018. And at this point, we're thinking that it's probably going to be more like August of 2018. So we are at this point off by just 2 weeks. I'll tell you that this is a pain in the butt to manage this construction project. I've never been involved in the management of a construction project. I spend every Thursday with a bunch of guys, and they're all guys in this room, with the contractors, with the architects, with the with all the other folks who work with us on this, keeping this on time. The only reason this project is on time is because our team at PAC has been so incredibly flexible. We have bent over backwards. Justin, Jose, the whole entire crew has been so incredibly flexible. We have changed our operation on a dime from one day to the next in order to keep our contractors' feet to the fire, in order to keep them moving forward. And I think that that has been really, really critical. That and the fact that I literally am there every single week putting the fear of God into the construction team saying, we will not finish, we will not be off schedule, because if we do, I will get lich. And so we're riding that one really hard, and not everybody enjoys it. So one of the things that has happened, one of the things that I believe is almost complete, is the first segment of the archaeology. We are compelled by state law to do a certain amount of archaeological preservation, and we have discovered in our site a village that dates back over 800 years. And it's really kind of cool. There's this complex of dwellings. There's fire pits. There's remains that have been found. There's cultural elements. I think it's really cool. But one of the things that I have said all along is that the archaeology cannot drive the timing for this project. And so you can imagine that well-meaning archaeologists, preservationists, want to really expand, and what I have said is no, we stay on course, we stay on budget, and we continue to move forward. And in fact, if I can get it under budget, any dollars that I save in any area are put into the contingency budget, which would go directly to benefit the animal areas of our building. So that's really critical. Sorry.
No, I just had a question. And I think we spoke a little bit about this, is that dollars for that $22 million is going for the animals and for the building and everything else, and not to excavate this.
Mr. Newman, members of the committee, so when you look at the bond budget, there's pieces that are broken out that have to do with site preparation, and this is actually one of the elements of site preparation. Now, this is one that I am managing very tightly, because when it's on our dime, when it's on the county's dime, I will not let it get too, it just won't be off budget. I just won't commit that it be off budget, because it is critical. The other piece is that, people, when you're doing it on somebody else's dime, sometimes you can get sloppy. And in this case, our job is to make sure that we do absolutely what's required by law to get done in terms of preservation, historic preservation, but not one iota more. And it's not because I don't care about this, because I actually do, and I find this really fascinating and cool, but because the dollars that we were entrusted by the voters are really, at the end of the day, meant to benefit animals as directly as possible. Yes.
About this, are they going to have any viewing of this? I know they're doing Sunset Road. They had only on weekends. Didn't affect the construction, and they had the archaeologists come. But anybody who wanted to come and take a look at the village or whatever it was, the farmland. Are they going to do anything like that on weekends, or they don't have?
Mr. Newman, Dr. Smith, I vetoed that idea because it would require resources.
Okay.
And given the fact that we have to simultaneously operate keep our operation moving forward, I just, even though would be a nice to have, I'm not willing to dedicate resources, nor am I willing to delay our project. So I have personally taken the blame for not allowing that to move forward. However, if we can do, we can do a very small VIP tour, if that is something that someone is interested in, we'll arrange it. But there's no way that we can.
It's a large donation.
It's a large donation.
It's a large donation.
We'll definitely arrange a VIP tour for that. But we're happy to arrange a VIP tour, but it's got to be, we just are not set up to deal with the kind of extra traffic that it just can't be done. So, finally, the volunteer program assessment. So one of the issues that this committee brought to me was trying to make sure that we were optimizing that they're not just the resource, the human resources that our volunteers brought to the table, their experiences, their knowledge, but really trying to see how we continue to grow that program in positive ways. And I'll tell you, here's an area where I absolutely knew nothing about, and that is volunteer programs. I have never been involved in the management of any volunteer programs. So I did what a neophyte in this area would want to do. That is, Justin and Jose went out and got a grant, not a money grant, but a technical assistance grant from a group that is coming in, essentially, has come in to begin to do kind of a program assessment. This assessment is called a service enterprise, and I'm just not going to bore you because I really don't know this deeply. Justin is the person who knows deeply how the service enterprise assessment is part of our volunteer program. But what I can tell you is that the assessment is covering these different areas of the volunteer program. How we're doing planning and development, how we're doing leadership support for the volunteers, how we're allocating resources. Resources means people, resources means time, resources means training, how we're tracking and evaluating, how we're doing outreach, how we're actually funding the volunteer program. For the first time, Justin has asked to pull out the volunteer program on its own as its own line item in the budget. Again, unprecedented for the county. We keep breaking a lot of rules at the county, and this is one of the ones that we are doing currently. Onboarding and supervision, technology communication, partnering, and extending the reach. These are all the different areas that are being critically evaluated. Now, my hope was to come in here and tell you everything's wonderful, and they've said that everything's perfect, and we're not quite there yet. But this is what's happened so far. So we're about 6 weeks into the 6-month programmatic assessment. The person who is the facilitator is somebody with a national reputation with a group called Points of Light Foundation. Her name is Beth Steinhorn, and she and her team are meeting with us on a weekly basis, meeting with our management team and project leaders to review, at least from the management side, how we're managing y'all as volunteers. Justin and the team has met with the facilitators to develop long-term ongoing action plan. But this is very much a work in progress. The first step in that work in progress was a self-assessment. And that self-assessment, unfortunately, says that we have a lot of things that we could do better. Out of a possible 100 points, I think we scored in the 60 range. I'm sure that for our volunteers and for our outreach people, they're just not that surprised. But for you across the table, you're probably not that surprised. But quite honestly, this is kind of the external feedback and the external assistance that we need. Jose, he knows how to run an animal welfare agency. We don't necessarily know how to run a volunteer program. That is not a muscle that we have. And so it is a muscle that we have to develop. And the only way we're going to develop it is by having some external assistance and some external eyes telling us, gosh, that is not even close to a best practice. Or you're doing that right. And I think that community-based organizations are a hell of a lot better at that. That's the space you swim in. Government is not good in this area. And so I think I know Justin and Jose feel like it, we have a lot to learn. We think we do a good job. We know that we can do a hell of a lot better. And as long as Jose and Justin had both said that they cannot envision a future where volunteers are not central to our operation. As long as that is the case, then we need to figure out how to move the volunteer program forward. And so this has been our attempt, my team's attempt, to address your concerns on that, knowing that there's going to be a lot of, in the process, we're going to uncover a lot of things that you might not be happy to hear, that you might not be happy to hear, but that we need to continue to work through if we're to be a professional organization. My team knows that. I've gotten pushback from, not from my team, but from folks in the community who said that we are trying to run a business. We're not trying to run a business. We are trying to run an enterprise. And in this enterprise, the main focus needs to be the animals that we serve, the companion animals that we serve. That's got to be, that's our customer. And the people who have those animals, that's our secondary customer. And then there's everybody else. And so we really are trying to focus on that primary customer. And that's why you hear people like Adam talking about the way he does about enforcement, because it's a much more animal-centered way of looking at enforcement. That's why we think that it is essential that we get a behaviorist, because that is our next frontier. You know, but we don't necessarily have those skills, and we're bringing some of them. So that's my sort of summary in terms of the terms of the management report. And I want to just take this opportunity to say I'm really thankful to all of you. I realize that I'm not always the easiest person to deal with, but I have really appreciated the wisdom and guidance that you've given us, and so that's part of the reason why we brought some refreshments, and we have a small token of our appreciation for each of the advisory committee members. And the county administrator has asked that I give you his thanks, and it, all the members of the committee will be receiving a nice Billbaum kind of sculpture for your service. So that's my report, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Garcia. That was good. We appreciate that. I liked it. I thought it was great. It gave you a really good background for the last 10 years on how things went. And considering the majority of us were involved in it, you kind of know where you fit in when you saw that, on how it went, where the battles were, whatever they may have been. It was really good. Thank you for doing that.
Well, the thing is, if you're putting out fires all the time, you don't really have an opportunity to do this. And for your team to put together that PowerPoint, it really means a lot. I mean, they're really going to see it. And I think it's very beneficial for the staff. So they're all going to be able to see this.
Absolutely. And what, one of the things that we want to do is, if any of you want this PowerPoint for your use, because we think this is, again, a public product, we're gonna send it to you so that you can use it.
Yeah, I'd like to send it. I'll be using your logistics to be able to send it to the volunteers.
Sure, absolutely. And,
I think it's pretty self-explanatory, but the volunteers are very interested in those things.
Mike is gonna give you a hard copy, and we will make sure it's scanned and it's available to you to send it to the logistics.
Well, thank you so much.
I can. For a donation. To the medical fund.
Of course. Spader.
But for you, for free.
Yes, I asked
something
last meeting.
There
was a reference. Last meeting, there was a reference to barking.
Yes.
Dog.
Here it is.
Sorry. Okay. None of us have ever seen that, so.
Mr. Chairman, Ms. Empton, I apologize. I omitted it from my manager's report, but I have all the material that you asked for, which is what are the communications that we send people, what are the educational pieces that go along with it, and it will be sent to you electronically. So, yes, ma'am.
The thing was, I asked you after the meeting, but you didn't have to have the tags. Dr. Sophia, you said let's get new tags or whatever. So,
Mr. Newman, the Semitage. So we have 10,000 tags that it's actually 10,000 of the old ones that we are going to go get through. It's not 10,000, but we have several thousand that we are going to get through. But we actually have ordered the new tags with the most updated information that I think meets the recommendations that we do.
Are you going to sticker on the back, like a license tag sticker that's got an expiration date so it's quick and easy to find out if it's valid or not? That's what one of my concerns was.
At this point, we have not made that decision yet. I want to get through these existing tag stock to see if we need to buy a different product that would allow us to do. You know, the material is not all uniformly. You have to have the right kind of material to put a sticker that's not going to come off, especially when it gets wet and stuff like that.
I was thinking what goes on the license plate for a car, just stick it on the back, and it's got the new number and
inspiration. I like your idea.
Thank you.
Well, with that, we move to the donations. Last month were $34,554 in May. So it's consistently staying right around the $35,000 to $40,000 mark, which is amazing considering when we first started, we were really happy that it was $2,000. No complaints, no commendations received by staff in May. Our last call to the audience. Yes?
Yes.
May I make one? So I wanted to, in the complaint and commendation department, let you know that we actually got a thank you note, not a thank you note, but a note of recognition from Congresswoman McSally for the work that PAC has been doing, kind of recognizing, I believe she visited. I couldn't understand why she was reaching out to me to say that we were doing a good job of that.
Okay. Marcy Berlin.
Hi, thank you, Marcy Allen with Mill Kill Pima County. I really appreciated the PAC 2.0, Dr. Garcia. I would like to ask for a little detail under the shelter operations deep dive. And I love that everything's become data-driven, and I think it would be really good to include as a category the live release rate details, because as you're narrowing down to reach no-kill, we really want to look at where are the remaining challenges. As we all know, the behavior is the biggest one now, but there will always be remaining challenges. And so to really be able to look at that in detail and study what we can improve on, that would be helpful. And the other thing, I'd like to request a correction to the PowerPoint, because the help desk didn't start in 2015. It started in 2014 with No-Kill Pima County. It was 2015 that the Friends of PAC added a staff person.
So 14 is even a greater year then.
So it's been, I'm afraid your 2014 listening should be longer.
I think so.
I think that we need to give a shout out to No-Kill Pima County and Marcy, because I think they have really driven this No-Kill community, and I think without them we would be anywhere near as far as we are. Thank you, Marcy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jack and I started back in 2010, so we saw a lot of these things that he demonstrated tonight, and it has come such a long, long way. You've all made extremely significant improvements, and your impacts as a volunteer, we feel them every day that we're down there and are going to live on for years to come. So I just wanted to tell you from the bottom of my heart, thank you. And not to take away from the committee,
but as a volunteer representative, I also want to publicly thank and acknowledge my volunteer representative, who also happens to be my husband, for all the amazing things he's done over the years to ensure the animals of this community have a voice. I've had the privilege, or should I say misfortune, to witness on a daily basis him giving blood, sweat, and oftentimes tears to this whole adventure. And he never took the role lightly, and I'm here as a witness to let you know that. I don't think a day ever goes by in our house when something about an animal or pack or something doesn't come up that he gets himself totally immersed in, and our life has become about animals day in and day out, and I thank him for that. I just wanted to read his favorite quote in case he doesn't later. It kind of like epitomizes who he is, and it's by Dr. Reagan, and some of you may have already heard it. And it's called, it says, "Animals have a life of their own that is important, of importance to them apart from their utility to us. They are not only in the world, but they are aware of it. And what happens to them matters to them." And Jack's passion for animals is the real deal. He's the real deal. And he truly does believe all animals matter. And I thank you for making a difference. And I'm proud of you and proud to be associated with you. Thank you.
As you can see, I have hired an advocate. Okay, next. Thank you for that. We have final observations by anybody here that wants to be here. Anybody on the team? Kind of like your last word.
I'll never have one of those.
Jodine?
Yes, I want to share with the enforcement. Enforcement officers, a law that was just a state law that was passed just recently, and I think it's a very, very good idea. I didn't bring it with me so I could tell you on which one it was. A state law that's just been passed and signed by the governor that says the animal control officers may have access to firearms and may use firearms when it is advisable out in the field, when it is necessary to, when there's a badly injured animal that needs to be put to sleep immediately or needs to be put out of its misery immediately, that you may use firearms to do that.
Yeah, I'll look into that law.
So I can tell you
a little bit about that law. That
what?
You're correct. Department of Agriculture, which where I retired from, there was a lot of that going on when they were putting down horses in Montana.
Yeah. This is an Arizona law. It was just signed by the governor fairly recently.
And it's nothing bigger than a 22 caliber.
Okay.
Is what the law says.
Up there, there were 40 horses.
Oh, really?
Well, it's a horse.
Oh, well, that's
a telemetry.
You mean thanks for making us aware and something that you do, and I'm sure there'll be other hurdles. It's just amazing what people do, have policies in place and trainings, and there's a lot to take in to make something like that happen. And it's a big change from what the culture and enforcement has been, so there's other things that we have to discuss. But
oh, yes, that's
there's a lot to these.
Would anybody else have any comments? No? Okay, well, I do. First, I wanted to thank all the volunteers. The volunteers, first and foremost, was what I got involved in. And considering how much they do, how much time they spend, how much money they spend, They do it all for free. And so working in concert with the staff at PAC, which have chosen that field, and it's so difficult to work there, they could be working somewhere else. So you have these two groups of individuals that, first, the volunteers that give, like Kathy was saying, blood, sweat, tears, money, their emotions, the rescues that do that, and then you have the individuals that are working there as well. I really can't say enough, because back in 2010 when I started, so much of this gelled because of that relationship between the two. And then we got involved, and then we all started looking at the operational aspects of it, which I understand now 2.0 is more strategic, but at the time it needed to be operational, because there were so many things that needed to be worked on and fixed, like you was talking about, the cleaning of the cages, the fact that too many dogs were in cages and things like that. So I understand the transition, and I think it's a very smart move. So I thank the committee for allowing, well, all of us, for putting so many agenda items on the agenda, and staying here till 8:30, 9 o'clock sometimes to get those things taken care of, talk about them. So I really appreciated that, because we got a lot done, and we should be proud of ourselves for that. So, thank you. Okay, do we have a motion to adjourn? Motion, do we have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Motion.